seated. First of all, I want to welcome everyone this morning to Riverview Baptist Church. We are thrilled to have you. If you are a guest, or if this is not your first time visiting with us, if you have visited with us in the past, if you've never filled out a visitor registration card, we just ask you to do that just so we can keep a track of who all is visiting with us. And also, that will give Brother Allen an opportunity to pray for you individually this week. And also, if you have a prayer request, you can write that on there and give that to him or Miss Christie at the end of the service, and then they have a special gift for you. If you are a father today, you just raise your hand. Thank you for not only being a father, but also being a father figure to someone that looks up to you. One of our great fathers of the church, Mr. T.A. Stewart, is home today. As some of you know, Miss Doris took a fall last week. She broke her hip. That's his wife, and she had surgery, and she's in a rehab facility. But Brother T.A. has been diagnosed with COVID, and so he can't go visit with her, and that's just tearing both of them up. They want to be together. They want to see each other. But since the whole family's been around each other, Miss Doris is quarantined, and she is not liking that. She wants to be around her children and her grandchildren and her husband. So just throughout the week, could you pray for the Stewarts and their family so that they can get through the rehabilitation and get over the symptoms of COVID. Also, one more announcement is our youth retreat is coming up the first weekend of July, 1st, 2nd, and 3rd. Grades 6 through 12, if you just finished any of those grades, you are more than welcome to go with us. We just need to get some information from you, and I need to give you some information. So if you haven't already signed up, that's still available. You just need to see me after the service, and we can get you lined up, okay? If you could, just pray with me this morning. Lord, we just come to you right now, humbly asking you to just invade this space with your presence this morning. We want to thank you for being the ultimate father to the fatherless, the guider, the lifter, the encourager that you are. We just pray as fathers that we could just have some of those traits, and that we could encourage, and that we could be the father to someone that looks up to us. We just ask that you be with the rest of the service, and that that as we continue to worship you, that you will be praised and glorified, and just be with Brother Allen as he delivers the sermon that you've laid on his heart this morning. All this in your name. Amen.
Well, I want to echo what Jonathan, our student pastor, said. Happy Father's Day to you. We're glad that you're here. A lot of you have your families here today. And we know that's a great, great blessing. As others make their way in, just make sure that they have a seat, okay? And we want to help them out. Marty, maybe you can help us if you don't mind, if they might need a seat or something. We might get some extra, all right? Well, we've got a special choir up here today. They don't look all that good, but they sound good, you know? I don't know that you could have Father's Day without singing this special, special song. Guys, I want this choir to sing the first verse and chorus. And we're going to ask you to join us as we brag on our Heavenly Father.
I've heard a thousand stories of
good.
he says, praise the Lord with instruments. And then all throughout the Word of God, we're told to sing. Usually we don't set up songs, we just let the song speak for itself. But I want to tell you, this is one of our great dads at Riverview. This is Herb Martin. And I asked Herb to sing this song on Father's Day because his own testimony is, this song is his testimony song. And after Herb had children, Herb got right with the Lord and everything changed once that happened. And this song is his testimony song. Listen. The New Testament book of Colossians, chapter 4. If you don't know where that is, you can look it up in your table of contents and find it. And I want to thank you for praying for me this week. As you know, the past 2 weeks I've had laryngitis. I've got some of my voice back. I pray that I won't start coughing in the middle of the sermon. So you pray about that.
Look out, Drew.
I was asked before the service, said, well, you've got 8 points on that sheet. I said, listen, don't worry about it. The first service didn't last but 2 hours and 15 minutes. Don't worry about it. We're going to move quick, okay? All right. Colossians chapter 4. I want to talk to you today about the type of men that we need. There's no denying the fact that our homes and our churches, our community, and our country need strong, godly men. And this message is not just for fathers, it's for all men. And ladies, I want to tell you that the Word of God is applicable. And so I think it would be a blessing to you as well. But we're honing in on the men today. And sometimes men get a bad rap on Father's Day from preachers. We praise the women on Mother's Day, and we usually come down hard on the fathers on Father's Day. Well, this is not a message like that. This is a message of encouragement. And as pastors, we think about Father's Day. And I just want to say, first of all, thank you to all the faithful and godly men we have here at Riverview. And I want to tell you, that's not just preacher talk, as I say. That really is true. And every chance I get to speak to the students, I try to tell them that that there are some godly men for our young men to look up to. There are some godly ladies for our young ladies to look up to. And I want to thank you. I want to thank you for that. And secondly, I want the Word of God to evaluate our hearts and our minds and our actions and our motives. And may we leave here today with a fresh zeal to serve the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And may some leave here today by asking the Lord Jesus to come into their heart and life and to save them. As the Apostle Paul concludes his letter to the church in Colossae, thus the name of the book Colossians, as he concludes his letter, the Apostle Paul mentions several men who have helped him in ministry. And these men, I believe, serve as an example of the type of men that our church needs, our homes need, our city needs, our county and our country needs. And we're going to look at 8 men that Paul mentioned. And as we do that, I encourage you men to look and to see and evaluate your heart and your motives and where you're at and say, God, here's where I need a little work on. God, help me to be like some of these men. The first man we see that Paul mentions, his name is Tychicus, okay? And in verses 7 and 8, we see this man, Tychicus, all right? Verses 7 and 8, look at it with me. As to all my affairs, Tychicus, our beloved brother and faithful servant, and fellow bondservant in the Lord will bring you information. For I have sent him to you for this purpose, that you may know about our circumstances and that he may encourage your hearts. Lord, I pray today that you would help me to preach the Word of God with anointing today. God, unless you speak to us, it's just mere words. But God, I need you today. Help us to be open to what you want to say to us today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. When we look at this man named Tychicus, we find that he is a faithful servant. Paul could count on Tychicus. He was willing to serve, and he was dependable. Have you ever been around somebody, perhaps it's a family member or friend or a co-worker, whatever, and you say, "Well, listen, I need some help Tuesday at 6 o'clock. And they said, "Oh, man, yeah, I'll be there. I'll be proud to help you." And Tuesday night at 6 o'clock, they had showed up. 6:15, still not there. 6:30, still not there. And you send them a text and you say, "Hey, everything okay? Everything good?" And they said, "Oh, no, I forgot. I forgot." Or they might say, "Something else just came up." I mean, it's hard to get things done if you're depending on undependable people. But Paul could count on this man named Tychicus. He was a faithful servant. He was willing to serve, and he was dependable. And this man reminds us that there is no job too small in the church. You see, Tychicus did errands for the Apostle Paul while Paul was in a Roman jail cell. In fact, Tychicus delivered Paul's letters to the different churches, including the letter that he wrote to the church at Colossae. Charles Stanley, who many of you know, says it this way: "Just think, if Tychicus refused to deliver Paul's letters to the churches, a great portion of the New Testament may have been lost." You think about that. If Tychicus had not delivered the letters to these churches, in this case to the church at Colossae, those letters could have been lost. So Tychicus reminds us that we need men who are dependable and faithful servants. Tychicus reminds us that there are no, quote, small jobs in the church. There are no small jobs in the church. I've heard so many comments in both services about the decorations and all. Some might think that's a small job. The ones who decorated it, no, it's not a small job. But I just want you to know, these decorations are just as important as everything else that's going to take place in Bible school starting tonight at 5:30. And we're going to be able to teach boys and girls about the love of the Lord Jesus, and they're going to do it in a fun and exciting way. I want to tell you, I remember last week I talked about we need some food. We need people. If you can't do anything else at Bible school, go buy a watermelon, slice it up, and bring it. They were wanting watermelon. I looked at the list, and a lot of you signed up for all that. I'm so thankful for that. You see, there's no job too small as you're serving the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And Tychicus reminds us that we need men who are faithful servants, dependable. You can count on them. The second man Paul mentions is a man named Onesimus. Onesimus, look at verse 9. "And with Tychicus, Onesimus, our faithful and beloved brother, who is one of your number, and they will inform you about the whole situation here." We find more about this man called Onesimus in the book of Philemon. You ought to read it. It wouldn't take you 10 minutes to read the book of Philemon. Let me tell you about Onesimus and Philemon. Onesimus worked for Philemon, and Onesimus wound up stealing money from Philemon. He stole money from him, and he took off and he squandered the money. But while he's running from Onesimus, the person he worked, while he's running from Philemon, the person Onesimus worked for, Onesimus comes in contact with the Apostle Paul. And the Apostle Paul shares the gospel, and Onesimus gets saved.
And Jesus changes his heart. And the reason I know that is because Onesimus went back to Philemon to say, listen, I'll repay you what I stole from you, and I'll continue to serve you and work for you. But Philemon says, listen, you're more important to Paul. You need to go help Paul. Onesimus reminds us that we need men who are born again. Born again. That's a great Bible word. It's a great Bible word. In fact, in the book of John, Jesus says you must be born again. What does he mean by that? Well, he means, and especially in John chapter 3, you'll find it, he means that we're born physically by water, right? Men, you remember the big exclamation, the water has broke. You remember that? And we're running around trying to get our wives to the hospital. You remember that? We're born physically, but you must be born again by the Spirit. We're born again spiritually. It's one thing to be born physically. It's another thing, and we must be born again spiritually. If you plan on going to heaven, if you plan on living abundant and having an abundant and eternal life, you must be born again spiritually. Onesimus was born again, and there was a change that took place from the inside and worked its way out. Can I share with you? I think it's so important when you get saved. Jesus says, you need to proclaim me publicly. Jesus has no secret disciples, none. He claims all of us to go public when we have a relationship with him. And the best way to do that, and the easiest way to do that, is to come down during an invitation and say, boy, I just got saved. And for me, not to have you give a speech, but for me to say, this person just asked Jesus into their heart and they're not ashamed of it. Boy, that's going public for Jesus. But can I say this? Just because you come down an aisle and you pray a prayer doesn't mean that you're saved. Because if there's been no inward change, there's been no salvation. Paul says it this way in Corinthians, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. You may have been baptized, but if you're not saved, you just got dunked. That's all that happened. You just got wet. That's all that took place. I'm just saying, it's a burden of mine. I've told you before, it's a burden of mine for people that come to church week in and week out. But they know, and God knows, that their heart is not right. They've never been saved. Well, Alan, how can you say that? Well, I can say it because Jesus said on Judgment Day, some will come and say, haven't I done this in your name? There'll be some preachers that'll come up. Say, Jesus, haven't I preached in your name? And Jesus will say, I'm sorry, I never knew you. In other words, I never had a personal relationship with you. Men, ladies, teenagers, I just want to ask you, do you know that you know that you know that you have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ? If you were to die today, do you know for certain that you would spend eternity in heaven? Has there been a real change that's taken place in your heart? Onesimus is the type of man that said, listen, there came a day where I got saved and Jesus changed my life. And I'm not ashamed of it. I pray if there's someone here today that's not saved, today, may it be the day. May it be the day. You know I'm an unconventional kind of guy, and you allow me just to follow the leadership of the Lord. I don't have to tell you this, but we didn't do this in the first service because I didn't feel led to do it. But I'm just going to ask everybody in the room, can we just give an invitation right now? Would you just bow your head, and if you want to be saved, you feel that tugging in your heart. Perhaps you've just been playing games with God, and there's been no change in your life. You know it, and God knows it. I'm telling you, what better day than on Father's Day to give your heart to our good, good Father? If you want to be saved, just silently where you're at, perhaps you would just say something like this: Lord Jesus, I'm a sinner. I can't get to heaven on my own. I need a Savior. Jesus, thank you for paying the punishment that I deserved on a cross for my sin. You took my place. You rose again from the dead. And Jesus, I surrender my life to you. Forgive me of my sin. Come into my heart and save me. Friend, if you prayed a prayer like that and you really meant it, Jesus meant it, and you just got saved, you just become a part of the family of God. I'm going to ask you. Nobody's looking around. I'm going to look. I want to see. I'm not going to call your name out. I'm not going to come back to you. I'm not going to embarrass you in any way. But I just want to know, if you just prayed and asked Jesus to come into your heart right now, would you just slip your hand up? And by doing so, you're just saying, Alan, I just prayed and asked Jesus to come into my heart. Amen? Amen. All right. Lord, thank you for saving some folks today. In Jesus' name, amen. Just look this way. Onesimus tells us that we must be born again. Thirdly, there's a man named... I practiced this all week, and I still don't know how to say it. Aristarchus. How about we just call him Big A? Can we do that? Steve James, the pastor at Bellevue, told some of us preachers, he said, when you come across names like this, just say it real fast, because you don't know how to say it, and they don't know how to say it. Let's just call him Big A. Can we do that? Big A tells us that we are a humble laborer. We ought to be a humble laborer. Look at verse 10. Big A, my fellow prisoner, sends you his greetings. Sends you his greetings. Let's just stop right there. Big A's name implies that he is of the so-called upper class of Macedonia. He renounced his place of prominence, and he labored with Paul. Now get this, in Acts chapter 19, Big A is described as Paul's traveling companion from Macedonia. And Big A was seized by an angry mob. And Paul's preaching, and here's why they were seized by this angry mob, because Paul's preaching had upset this guy named Demetrius and his fellow workers who built idols, false idols. They built false gods. And when all these people got saved, they came after Paul, because the whole city had been turned upside down, and these people had turned from worshiping these false idols to turning to the true God. They turned from worshiping these gods that had to be made with hands to a God who was not made with hands. He's the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. They were building these false gods who had to be propped up, and they turned to a God who does not need to be propped up. He is eternal. He sits on the throne. He'll always be on the throne. He will never abdicate his throne. And the people in the city got upset, so they came after Paul. And what Big A did was he stepped and he stayed with Paul, and they arrested Big A. All right? They arrested him. What does this tell us? Now listen, if you're visiting here today, you don't know me, and so I'm trusting that you'll hear my heart. Riverview, I'm trusting you'll hear my heart. What I'm about to say might sound self-serving, but I promise you it's not. We're taking it right here from the text. But do you know what this man did? You know what this man did? He protected the preacher. He protected Paul. Now listen, I'm not trying to be funny. This is not self-serving. But as I was studying this passage, I got a phone call last week from a pastor. It doesn't happen every week, but I want to tell you, it's not a rare occurrence. Brother Jerry and I get calls quite frequently from pastors. I got a call from a pastor, and he was discouraged. And here's why he was discouraged. He just had people in his church that are just flat out mean. Did you know Baptists sometimes can be mean? I don't know if y'all knew that or not. They just stay on him. He couldn't do anything right. I mean, if he said, let's go left, they said, let's go right. I mean, he preached too long or too short. They're just on him all the time. And when I get calls like that, honestly, Christy can tell you, we talked about it. I ache for them, and at the same time, I feel guilty. I feel guilty because thank God that's not happening here. And again, I just want to say thank you. I'm not always right, but we pray through things and we try to make the best decision. And there's been times since I've been your pastor, there's been a couple times where I've had to come back and say, listen, I missed it. Thank you for praying. Thank you for praying for me so that we can come to God's will together. Some churches, some pastors don't have the congregation like Riverview. And I've just been reminded this week that our churches need some men in particular that will come and lock arms with the preacher and say, preacher, we're going to stand behind you. And if somebody's running you down, if somebody wants to get to you, they're going to come to me first. I know that sounds so self-serving, but I hope you're hearing my heart. And again, I just want to say thank you. Thank you. And Paul had that kind of man. The fourth man Paul talks about, you're familiar with him. His name is Mark. John Mark, he wrote the Gospel of Mark. We find it here at the end of verse 10. And also Barnabas's cousin Mark, about whom you received instructions. If he comes to you, welcome him. Let me tell you about this man, Mark. Mark indicates that there are restored relationships. Can I just tell you real quick, as you read the book of Acts, you're going to find that Paul went on a mission trip. And he took Barnabas and Mark with him. Barnabas and Mark were cousins. Here's what began to happen. They're on this mission trip, and Mark says, boys, I can't take this any longer. I'm going to the house. I'm going home. Now, the Bible does not tell us why Mark left. Perhaps he got sick. Maybe he got homesick. Maybe he was afraid of the pain that was going to he was going to incur if he kept hanging out with Paul. We don't know why Mark left, but we do know this. We do know this. It hurt Paul very deeply. So Paul gets ready to go on a second mission trip, and Barnabas says, "Hey, Paul. Let's get old Mark. He's changed. He's going to do better this time." And Paul said, "No way, Jose. I'm not going to take Mark. He's already left his high and dry once. I'm not going to let it happen two times." And the Bible says there arose a sharp dispute between Paul and Barnabas. So Paul gets Silas, Barnabas gets Mark, and they go their separate ways, and God still uses both of them. But as we come to this particular verse, and in 2 Timothy is the last letter Paul ever wrote before he died. And this passage and the one in 2 Timothy, Paul says, listen, I want you to bring Mark. I want you to bring Mark because he's helpful to me in the ministry. What does that mean? That means that somewhere along the way, Paul and Mark had a restored relationship. The relationship was restored. Man, anybody in the room, I just want to tell you, if there's a rift between you and somebody else, you do what you can do to restore the relationship. Now, Paul goes on to say, as best as it depends on you, be at peace with all men. You do know that some people, they don't want to restore relationship. They like drama. They love drama. They want to keep things stirred up. So all you can do is what you can do. But Mark reminds us that there are some men who were at odds, but they got right with the Lord and with each other. Verse 11 tells us of another man Paul wanted to give kudos to, and that man is named Justice. Justice. And Justice reminds us and sets the example that he encouraged others. That's what Justice did. Look at verse 11. And also Jesus. We won't get into all that. That was a name some people had, who is called Justice. These are the only fellow workers for the kingdom of God who are from the circumcision. Now get this. And they have proved to be an encouragement to me. Listen, in a time of loneliness, in a dirty, stinking, rotten jail cell, Justice came along and was an encouragement to Paul. Riverview, can I tell you? We need to be encouragers. We need to be encouragers. Notice here that Paul did not tell of extraordinary works that Justice did. He didn't tell of Justice healing people. He didn't tell of Justice doing anything extraordinary. He just said, Justice, encourage me. Can I tell you? Some people don't need you to do something big for them. Some people just need a word of encouragement. In fact, I want to tell you this. Most of the time, what we'll remember is not the big thing someone has done for us. It's something like encouragement. That's what Justice did. Now, men, can I just share with you? I get it. Sometimes we're too macho. Sometimes we think the ladies are better at this than I am. And they are. They are. Sometimes it's hard for us to encourage another man, okay? But men, I want to tell you, Paul thought so much about it and thought so much about this man that he said, listen, I just want to include him. And when Justice comes your way, I want you to receive him because he's been an encouragement to me. Men, can I just encourage you? Can I challenge you? Can I challenge all of us to encourage one another? I want to challenge you. Sometime this week, if you don't do it every morning, at least do it one morning. Do this. Say, God, would you put on my heart somebody that I can encourage today? Maybe it's somebody I see. Maybe it's somebody I don't see, but I think about them. And God, help me to encourage them. And I want to challenge you. Men, send the text. Make the phone call. Send the email. If you see them in person, shake the hand and say, listen, I just want to tell you, you're a great blessing to me. Maybe it's another man. Maybe it's some men in this church. Maybe you just go to them and shake their hand and say, listen, I want to tell you, I love you. I want to tell you, you're a blessing to me. Maybe it's a man that's hurting in this church and you go to him and you say, listen, shake their hand. Maybe even hug them and just say, listen, I just want you to know I'm praying for you. I know you're going through a tough time. I'm praying for you. I'm just telling you, ladies do this very well. Men, not so much. But Paul thought it so important that he said, listen, Justice encouraged me. What about men? Would you take that challenge? of just praying and saying, God, help me just to see through spiritual eyes and help me to encourage somebody today. Number six is Epaphras. Epaphras. Epaphras was a prayer warrior. Look at verses 12 through 13. Epaphras, who is one of your number, a bond slave of Jesus Christ, sends you his greetings, always laboring earnestly for you in his prayers, that you may stand perfect and fully assured in all the will of God. For I testify for him that he has a deep concern for you and for those who are in Laodicea and Hierapolis. Epaphras was a prayer warrior. The Bible says Epaphras fought in prayer for the people of God. Listen, is prayer a duty or is it a delight? The answer is yes. Because when we really get down to praying, Satan will throw everything he can to stop us from praying. Because it's prayer that moves the hand and the heart of God. And we need some men. We need some ladies. We need some teenagers who will pray. Pray. Not just God's good, God's great, let's thank for our food. Not just that, but I'm talking about like Epaphras. He prayed. Prayer was essential to him. Prayer was an imperative for him. Prayer was emphasized in his life. And Epaphras prayed specific prayers for specific people. And God answered. Well, Alan, what did he pray? It says it right here. It says it right here. He prayed that you may stand perfect and fully assured in all the will of God. He prayed that the people would be spiritually mature, they would grow in the faith, and they would know the will of God. I just want to mention this, okay? I'm not putting a guilt trip on. I just want to remind us, because I don't announce this every week. But on Thursday mornings at 7 o'clock, from 7 to about 7:30, about 30 minutes, we come in and we pray. Sometimes we'll have 12, sometimes 13, sometimes if people are out of town, sometimes 6 or 7. I just want to encourage you. Well, I'm not praying at home. Sure you can. Please do. I just want to tell you, if you ever get in on these prayer meetings, there's just something about what happens is the women pray together and the men pray together. And we've got some that come that don't verbalize a prayer. They don't feel comfortable praying out loud, but they're praying and agreeing with us. So I just want you to know, you don't want to pray. If you don't want to pray out loud, audibly, that's fine. All right? But it's just something. But Jesus says, where two or three agree in my name is touching anything, it'll be done. They're not in the room, but I want to tell you this. This just doesn't apply to old people. It applies to teenagers. It applies to young people. Josh and Tiffany Causal here had three boys. Three boys. And last Sunday morning, as you know, if you were here in the second service, my mom came down the aisle and asked people to pray. And the ladies gathered around her and prayed. Mom fell a couple of months ago, had a brain bleed, and it didn't get any better. And she dealt with she said 5-10 times worse than a migraine. Headaches, it'd make her nauseous. She'd stay sick all the time. The dizziness, that kind of thing. And they called and said the brain bleed had got bigger. They wanted her to come last Tuesday to the doctor. And we were expecting she was going to have surgery. They're going to have to drill a hole in her head and all that kind of stuff. She's going to have brain surgery. Mom came down last Sunday. You ladies gathered around her and prayed. But what I will tell you about, bless my heart, Tiffany, Josh and Tiffany's boys, one of them said, Brother Allen, I'm going to pray for you, Mama. I said, boy, that'd be great. Thank you. And they told me that there was one night when they went to bed, and they came back in there, if I remember correctly, and told Josh, said, we need to pray again. We forgot to pray for Brother Allen's mom. And they prayed. And can I tell you, mom's here today. She's a greeter today. She was able to come, went last Tuesday, and they said, no surgery, and things are getting better. And in about a month, you ought to be pretty much as good as new. And I want to tell you, all this week, she's had great days. It's an answer to prayer. Whether you're a small boy or whether you're an old man, right? It's prayer. And so we need some men like Epaphras that'll pray. Number seven is old Luke. You're familiar with Luke. He wrote a gospel in the New Testament. And we find from Luke that he was a man who was skillfully engaged. Look at verse 14. Luke, the beloved physician, sends you his greetings. Luke was a doctor. And Luke used that skill to honor the Lord by serving others. Luke used his skill as a doctor to serve God by serving others. I want to tell you, I thank God for our medical personnel. I thank God for doctors and nurses and EMT. I'm thankful that God uses them. I want to tell you who else. I'm thankful for guys who know how to build stuff and repair things. Because for guys like me, you guys are a great blessing. I don't know how to do any of that. And we need some men who will use their skill to just serve God and serve the church and serve others. Can I say this? Our open door ministry downtown, where we're going to be ministering to ladies who are coming out of jail and that kind of thing. We should be, hopefully by the end of next month, we'll be able to start. But here's one thing that we need. I just want to mention this because maybe there's some men that could help. I don't know. But the area when you walk in, the part that used to be the dentist office, that small part up there, new flooring needs to be put down in those three little rooms. New flooring needs to be put down. And that's kind of what we're waiting on. And so, Diane McGee, is she here? She went outside to smoke. No, there she is. I'm kidding. Diane, stand up for real. Stand up. I'm kidding. You understand I'm kidding. I will get flogged after church for that, okay? Hey, that's Diane McGee. Gentlemen, if there's anybody that could say, hey, I could take a couple hours, I might not could do the whole thing, but I could help some and lay some flooring. If you would see Diane and give her your name and say, hey, I could help. I don't know that I could do the whole thing, but I could commit a couple hours. See Diane after church. And you'll be just like old Luke. He just used his skill set to serve others. We come to the last name. I would love to end this message on a high note. But sadly, the text does not end on a high note. The last name I want to mention to you is Demas. Demas. And Demas reminds us of a failed legacy. Look at the end of verse 14. Luke, the beloved physician, sends you his greetings, and also Demas. Let me tell you about Demas. Demas started out the race very well. He started out serving. But in 2 Timothy chapter 4, verses 10 and 11, here's what it says about Demas. Look at the screen. For Demas, having loved this present world, has deserted me. Demas started the race good, but yet his legacy was that he loved the present world too much and he turned his back on God and he went back to the ways of the world. Demas just simply quit. He quit on his fellow brother in Christ. He quit on God. The things of the world became more important to Demas. Men, I want to beg you today, please don't quit on God. Please don't quit on God. Please don't quit on your church. We need you. And God forbid that we quit on our families. Please don't quit on your family. Or your children need you. Your wife needs you. Please don't quit. I beg you. I want to give you these two take-home principles. Here's how we can be the type of men that Riverview needs, your family needs, and your country needs. These examples. But I just want to finish with this. Finish well. Don't go back on God. You keep pressing forward and run the race. And when you cross the finish line, you'll hear God say, well done, good and faithful servant. And men, I want to encourage all of us, starting with the preacher, may we stay close and may we stay clean. May we stay close to God and may we stay clean in our mind, our thoughts, our words, our actions. May we stay close and may we stay clean. There was a couple of hands that went up today. Said they got saved. A couple of people that don't live here. So they're not going to join this church because they don't live here. But I will encourage you, listen to me, if you raised your hand, if you got saved today, I will encourage you. I'm going to be standing right over there, okay? And I want you to come in just a moment. We're going to stand and Shirley's going to play. I want you to come and say, Brother Allen, I just got saved. I'm not going to ask you to give a speech, but I just want to tell the congregation you got saved today. Would you do that? I'm going to be standing right over there. The invitation is going to be a little different. I'm going to ask every man, not just fathers, young men, young adult men, older adult men, teenagers, young boys, if you can and will and you feel led, I'm going to ask you just to come and line up here across this altar, just facing this way, and I'm going to ask Dr. Jerry Spencer to pray for us. Because we need godly men. And when you come into this altar, you're just saying, I want to do my best to be a godly man. I want to line up with some of these men that we talked about today. And Brother Jerry's just going to pray a prayer for you. I'm not going to make you come, but if you feel led to do that, just line up across here facing that way. But if you got saved today, I just want you to come down. I'm going to stand right over here. So I'm going to ask everyone to stand. Man, if you feel led, you just come. And we're going to have Brother Jerry pray for us. If you got saved today, I'm standing right here. You just come and say, well, I just got saved, okay? Would you do it?
Some habit that they have a difficulty getting rid of, maybe it's because their children are not serving the Lord, but their grandchildren. I pray for those men. Calm their hearts, be a balm and get into them, and work out the heartaches and things they're praying about. Answer those prayers. Then, Father, we thank you for the men who are responsible. Pay the price, go the second mile, turn the other cheek. God be with each one of them. Encourage them, strengthen them, energize them, guide them as we try to be the men of God. Thank you again for the man of all men, the God-man Jesus, who came and died upon the cross and rose again, and our wonderful Savior. May he be so real in our lives. May we allow him to stand up in us and be who he is, so we can be who we are in the Lord. In Jesus' name, thank you. Amen.
Amen. As you're finding your way back to your seat, would you be seated just a moment? Well, God's been moving today, and I'm so thankful. And men, again, I want to tell you, I thank the Lord for you. And may we be a church where the men lead the way in loving the Lord and loving others. I'm going to ask Lisa Stoddard and Paul to come, and they have their great nieces here this week. And remind me of your names. Lana, this is Lana. And this is Leela. And this is Layla. Layla. You know how I made that name up, Big A? I'm going to start calling you Little L. Okay? And this is Kristen's cousins and all. And so when we prayed during the sermon, and I look back and they raised their two hands and said, I just got saved today. They live out of town. They're visiting Paul and Lisa and Kristen this week. I said, ladies, can I just introduce you to the church? And he said, yes. And I said, listen, I want you to call your folks today and tell them. And when you get back home, you get in a church if you're not already, and be baptized and serve the Lord there. But if you're thankful for these two young ladies who just gave their heart to the Lord, heaven's rejoicing, and I thank you all for it. Thank you so much. Amen. Hey, guests, if you're here, you're visiting with us today, I hope that you filled out a card, because my wife is on her way to the back. I'm going to follow her in just a moment. We're going to be under the TV in the foyer. And if you'll give us that card, we want to give you a special gift just saying thank you for coming today. Hey, gentlemen, we've got a gift for you. And so we've got some folks out there that's going to give you a gift. And I think we have plenty. I think we do. And so I think, Jonathan, you think we have enough just to open it up to all the men or not? We better stick with dads. Better stick with dads, okay? Better stick with dads. Let's do that. So all the dads are going to get a free gift. Make sure you get that on your way out. Hey, let me mention one thing to you. Next Sunday, we're having service at 8:15, 10:15, okay? We will have equipping classes next week. But next Sunday at 2 o'clock, we're having our annual Let Freedom Ring concert. And it's going to be, we're going to be honoring our military, our veterans, our law enforcement. We're going to celebrate God. We're going to celebrate our country. I want you to come, invite some people with you to come. Brother Jared, you've got two of your daughters here today, don't you? We're glad that they are here. And you take them out and buy them something good for lunch, okay? All right. Hey, I love you. Yes, I'd love to see you and meet you. God bless you. Have a great week.